This is Iowa State champ Alex Thompson.
This is Josh Elwer from the University of Northern Iowa, and you're listening to Potentially Dangerous on IA Wrestle.
Is this heaven?
No. It's Iowa.
From high school to international wrestling, on the mat and beyond, this is the Potentially Dangerous Podcast with the guys from IA Wrestle.
If you're a fighter, you like a fight. If you're an American, you like a fight. If you're an Iowa Hawkeye, you know you're going to get a fight.
Subscribe to our podcast on iTunes and all your podcast-friendly apps. And follow us on social media platforms at IA Wrestle. Time to strap it up and get to the show.
All right, welcome back to Potentially Dangerous. My name is Nic Ryder. I'm the host now. But with me, making his triumphant return back to the podcast, is Ross Bartachek.
Triumphant seems, I don't know if it's the right word, but definitely glad to be back. It's been like 2 months.
No, that's the right word. Ross has been busy, you know, having babies and taking care of his wife. And we're glad to have him back. Baby and mom are doing well, so we're happy for them. And yeah, that's also, if anyone hears a dog bark, that's one of my dogs. Sorry. We're a little out of control over here tonight.
We're a real professional unit right now.
For sure. If you guys have any questions or anything, hit us up in the comments. We may or may not see them. It's a little, like I said, it's the first time I'm hosting, so I'm a little, I got a lot going on. The dog is barking up at me, so. But yeah, hit us up with your comments. We'll try to get them answered. This is episode 113. Did I already say that? I don't know.
I'm not sure.
Oh, Potentially Dangerous.
Yeah, I was just going to say, did we even say what show we are?
I don't know. I'm turning into shares here, so.
Yeah.
Anyway, first up, talk some coaching changes. Ryan Morningstar did not get the head coaching job at South Dakota State, like we all predicted last week. Han got it from Cornell. I'm blanking on Han's first name right now.
Damian Han.
Damian, yeah. Long-time runner-up for some other jobs. Finally gets the call to the bigs. Ross, what are your thoughts on the whole South Dakota State thing, since we haven't heard from you yet?
I think, towards the end of the South Dakota State job opening up, I think, you know, there was some strong interest from Ryan about wanting to take the job and interviewing. I'm not sure, you know, how hot and heavy Damian was in on this. I think he's from New Jersey, but he wrestled college at Minnesota. So, he's kind of from that area where he wrestled, and he can pull recruits from Minnesota. So I'm sure that was very attractive for the South Dakota State program. But I think, more or less, this was kind of just something Ryan was dipping his toe in the water, kind of testing it out, seeing what it was like. And I think, you know, South Dakota State was very receptive to him. I think he's got a lot of things going for him. I heard you guys talk about, why he would be a good candidate for South Dakota State, and I agreed with all those things. But really, I think, I'm not even sure if the job didn't go to Damian Han. Like, I don't know the specifics, but I'm not 100% sure that Morningstar took this job if it was offered to him. You know, I'm not sure if he got the call for the offer, but I'm not sure he takes it no matter what. I think he might have stayed in Iowa City.
Well, I think if he interviewed and was offered the job, I think he for sure takes it. I don't think you interview for that type of, at this level for, and then not get offered the job, then not take it. That's kind of crazy.
That's a good point, but I really do think this was kind of, I think there was some initial interest in wanting it and kind of putting his name out there. But I think at the end of the day, he's kind of the lead recruiter there at Iowa. And he's the reason, Alex Marinelli came for sure. 100%. If you ever talk to Alex, that's what he says. And I think he played a pretty big role for Kemmer and Caleb Young and a lot of other those middleweights. I think a lot of guys have ties to him, and I just know that bond with Marinelli would have been pretty tough to leave. And I just think the way the program's trending, to me, you know, it would be a good idea to put your name out there, see what you're getting. And maybe, you know, if Iowa can turn around and win a national title here in 2 years, he can pick any job he wants. You know, it can be a more major program, not just a mid-major job that he's looking for. So I think this was kind of a learning experience. That's kind of what I think it is more. I don't know if you would have taken it.
Sure. I mean, maybe he was offered and declined it, and that's why Han got it. I mean, I don't think we'll ever know.
Yeah, I was going to say, I definitely don't know if he was offered, but I think, I think, you know, there was some strong interest to stay back home too, so.
Sure. I mean, maybe he got out there and was like, man, Brookings is far from everything, and the Arby's is not that good.
That's what I was going to say, man. He's like, you know, this Arby's got talked up, but, you know.
Not that great.
It's just not the same, you know. There's one of those in North Liberty now that's not that far from his house. So he's like, man, if I want Arby's, I can just go to North Liberty. So,
for sure. Other coaching news, it kind of broke Sunday. I do know at the World Cup, it was kind of cool. The photographers were just kind of, you know, sitting around talking before one of the rounds, and someone hands someone their phone and says, hey, did you see this? And it was Matt McDonough is going to Wisconsin. So we kind of, I don't know if we were first on it or what, but, you know, we just posted that on Sunday. And
I think we broke it.
Did we? But yeah, Matt McDonough's leaving Eastern Iowa and going up to Wisconsin to join Chris Bono and John Reeder and be a Bucky Badger. So, you know, it's a great move for him. Extend that Tom Brands coaching tree out a little bit further. And, you know, Wisconsin gets a great guy, Matt McDonough.
And this is kind of like this is definitely a home run for the Bono crew. You know, at South Dakota State, I feel like he had a pretty good staff there when he still had AJ Shop. You know, he had a strong, lightweight guy that, you know, really good on top. And we saw a lot of development in Seth Gross from his freshman to sophomore year. I know he dropped weights too, but he really seemed to grow getting a good lightweight in there. And that's just something that's a lot harder for Bono and Reeder to do, is work with those smaller guys. So that's what I think, you know, when South Dakota State was really clicking is when they had, you know, Bono in the middle lower weights, got Reeder upper weights, and they had a really strong lightweight coach. I think this McDonough really complements them to set it up to, you know, hit the ground running in Wisconsin. And with Matt's ties to Iowa, you know, they already kind of had Iowa ties to begin with. They can really start pulling from Eastern Iowa, which is where we see a lot of, you know, it's a good recruiting bed for Wisconsin, you know, Eastern Iowa.
For sure, yeah. I mean, McDonough's been the coach of the whatever club that is here in Eastern Iowa for the EIWC. And been doing really well with those guys, so you think he'd have ins with a lot of kids with the through that. And by the way, my wife's home now, so she's, for those of you watching the podcast, which is like seven of you, she's right there.
Oh,
listening, you can't see her, obviously. So,
No, the other thing about just to kind of hit on that Eastern Iowa Wrestling Club, I think we got to credit Lars Underbakke of IA Wrestle.
Who?
He said Brandon Sorensen is going to take up McDonough's role as, I guess I don't know if it'll be director of the Eastern Iowa Wrestling Club or what his official title will be, but I think Sorensen's going to step into that role, which means he'll be staying in Iowa City.
Yeah, that's good, I suppose. Keep him around the program and kind of keep an eye out for, you know, that talent from the EIWC that can maybe go down to Iowa City. Yeah, it's good. It's a good move for Sorensen, and it's the first step of a hopefully long career.
Yeah, I mean, Iowa's definitely needed like a 70-kilo guy to stick around the club. I feel like it's always been, you know, 65 and lower, and then, you know, Ketty and Brooks, and then a couple of, you know, heavyweights. It's always that middleweight ground has always been kind of a barren weight for the Hawkeye Wrestling Club to keep those post-college guys around to help train the current crop.
Yeah, that's kind of true. I mean, they have the Dardanes. They're right around there, aren't they?
I think they're 61 and 65. I think Nick's the bigger one.
So. And Lars just commented he thinks the EIWC is planning on another coach too. So, I mean, rich keep getting richer. So we'll see who that is eventually. And yeah.
But I mean, and just kind of back to that, I mean, the McDonough, I mean, did you find it surprising that this, you know, he took this job? I think, you know, Chris Bono gave an interview that he's been offered a job every year since he's graduated. I mean, does it kind of surprise you that this was the first one he took then?
I heard that too. I was kind of surprised me just that hearing that he'd been offered a job every year since he's graduated. That was kind of like, really? And then Bono said too that that Bono went after McDonough when he first went to South Dakota State and was, you know, really trying to get him in there. So it's, I mean, it's not, I don't think it's surprising that he didn't want to go to SDSU. But, you know, Madison is great. It's a great college town. It's in the Big Ten. It's really not that far away from, Eastern Iowa Cedar Rapids here. It's like a 3.5 hour drive or 3 hour drive. So he's still, you know, you're still kind of close. Wisconsin, I don't know that it's the sleeping giant that, like, Ohio State or Penn State, like, are or were or whatever a few years ago. But, you know, it's a solid – it's a good program, and they're in the Big Ten. They have a lot of resources, and it's – I hope it works out for them. Like, they should do well.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like a good move on paper, but it – I'm not going to lie, when before we obviously we broke the news, so we kind of knew McDonough obviously was the name. I just kind of got to preface my statement here that when, you know, I knew Bono was looking for a lightweight coach, honestly, the name that came to my mind was Tony Ramos. That's who I thought he was going to call, you know, just because he would have been a similar situation where, you know, he was a Hawkeye favorite, so he could probably recruit Iowa. He's at, you know, in North Carolina now, and he's pulling kids from Illinois. There's a kid from Wisconsin that's currently committed to North Carolina. So I just kind of thought that, you know, I thought for sure he was going to go after him. They have that Badger RTC, so they could have gave him some money to keep training, because obviously Ramos said he wants to continue through 2020. So that's where I thought they were going to go. So, I mean, I was a little bit shocked that, you know, when they said, well, they're really going after McDonough hard, I was like, oh, wow, I guess, you know, that's another slam dunk hire, but just kind of threw me off my balance.
Yeah, and, I mean, the thing about Ramos is, like, they, like, him and his family just moved to North Carolina, though. I mean,
right.
That was 2 years ago or 2.5 years ago. So maybe they're comfortable down there and don't want to move all the way back up here again.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I
totally
don't even know if they.
I don't know.
I was just gonna say, I don't even know if he picked up the phone and called him.
Yeah,
but
right.
I mean, that's just kind of like when I was thinking, somebody that can recruit the heck out of the Midwest is Tony Ramos, because if you can get guys, I mean, I know North Carolina is a pretty sweet destination, but if you can get guys in Illinois out there, that's, I mean, you're doing your job. That's what he does. He recruits Illinois, so.
Right. For sure, but yeah, I mean, I'm happy for McDonough. I think I maybe said hi to him once, but, you know, he's a great guy, and we wish him all the best up in Wisconsin. It gives us another reason to go up there. They Wisconsin has a really cool arena. I think it's just called the Fieldhouse. It's where their volleyball team plays, and it's a super old building, and you're real close to the mat, and it's wrapped around. And then it's got an upper deck, too, that's quite steep. But the upper deck has been closed for years because it's not fire safe or whatever.
Right.
So they're renovating part of it. So they're going to open part of it back up. And I think it's mostly for volleyball because they're, like, top 10 in attendance in volleyball. But it should be open for wrestling, too. And with the, you know, renewed energy, hopefully they can get that place rocking a little bit and you know, just see that. See them grow and expand, and that's great for wrestling.
Yeah, I already saw their Twitter account was, I think it was maybe a men's basketball or women's basketball tweet, and they had the upper deck, like you're talking about, completely open, and it was full. And I think, you know, the Badger wrestling account's like, we see you, upper deck, you know, or something like that. I was like, that's pretty. I was like, man, my man Nic Ryder was just talking about this.
Now, Bono, I mean, Bono's got them on that social media stuff already. Like, they're producing videos and they're tweeting stuff out. I mean, he's good at that stuff. That's what he did at South Dakota State. He's great at it.
Also, do you think when Damian Hahn finally accepted the job at South Dakota State, the AD was like, all right, you got to get on Twitter now because that's what Bono did? Because did you see he got Twitter? Just today or something. Like, he finally joined Twitter.
I mean, that's a different game, like, being a head coach. And I know Mac Ryder talked about this on Shots Fired, which everyone should check out. Shots Fired, it was posted Tuesday, today. Sometime in the afternoon, Mark Ryder and Eric shares. It was good.
They hit record. Cool.
Yeah, they got it all recorded. Eric sounds like he's in a well, but, you know, audio issues, whatever. Ryder was talking about how being a head coach now, it's not now, but it's always kind of different. You're not just an assistant who can just roll around with the guys all the time. You got to manage every aspect of your program, from recruiting to social media stuff to, you know, the technique part. Game day ops, like, all that stuff goes into being a head coach. And like, while you're ready for it, that first 2 years kind of really hits you hard, I think. But that's what you got to do. You got to be on Twitter now. You got to interact with fans. You got to raise money. You got to do all that stuff that you don't really think about when you're just signing your name on the paper, maybe.
Right.
Do you have anything else on coaching stuff?
Oh, it kind of popped up today, so I'm going to spring this one on you because it wasn't in our pregame notes. But it was Tim Flynn of Edinburgh took the West Virginia job.
Yeah.
And we really don't have a whole lot to say on this right now. But the only interesting note that I have is Cliff Moore, who was a national champion, three-time All-American at Iowa. I think he wrestled at Dubuque Hempstead High School. He's been an assistant coach at Edinburgh for like 12 years. And I think it'll be really interesting. You know, I don't know. I love following Iowa natives wherever they are. So I think it'll be really interesting to see if he follows Flynn to West Virginia. And, you know, now he's going to be a big assistant at a bigger college. And that can eventually springboard him to a head coaching job of his own someday. Or if he's just going to try and take that Edinburgh job. Which the Edinburgh job's kind of it's always kind of considered risky since it's not, I don't think it's a fully funded program. You know, Tim Flynn's just always done really good things there. So, I'm just really interested to see what Cliff Moore does, just cause like I said, I love watching Iowa natives, you know, do their thing across the country.
Right. I mean, he's been at Edinburgh so long, you'd think he'd want to slide in there and be the top guy. But like I said, being the top guy is a totally different ballgame than being an assistant.
Right, and you know, it's. I think there's been, or maybe it was just Lugo, but I feel like there's been, some guys transferring out of that program, and then you see Flynn leave. That, you know, I mean, kind of makes you a little bit nervous. What's going on there? Maybe something with the administration, but just kind of thought I'd throw that out there. Also means that Kerry Kolat didn't get the West Virginia job. So Zach Barnes, Iowa native, they're out there at Campbell, and Aiden Reeves probably a little bit happy that their coach is staying put. So
for sure, yeah. My only thing with Flynn was, what are the singlet designs going to be now at West Virginia? Are they going to go checkered, or are they going to go flannel, or what?
It's going to be like a mountain man outfit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it's going to look like.
If they could somehow integrate the beard, like, down into the singlet, like, that'd be kind of cool.
And then I think, like, some guys are going to wear, like, a one-arm sleeve, and it's going to be, like, their musket. And when they celebrate and they do, like, one of those, it's like they're shooting a musket. I mean, I'm pretty sure that's what's going to happen, at least.
That'd be fantastic. I'd be on board. All right.
That's coaching news.
Yeah, we're done with that. Let's move on to the World Cup. Of the two of us, I was the only one that was there. I took photos for all the sessions I was there. If you haven't seen my photos, go to flickr.com/IARussell and click on the World Cup albums. That's what they're called. And check them all out. I took this awesome one of Kyle Dake that I'm sure everyone has seen now 100,000 times, but I thought I'd throw it up there anyway. It's pretty sweet.
Is the Azerbaijan, is that duel on Flickr yet?
Oh, it's not. No, the gold medal match. I was editing those, and then I had to reset my computer, and it turned into a big thing, so those aren't up yet. But tomorrow, I promise, but hopefully by the time this drops on the actual podcast, like the audio on iTunes and stuff, those will be up. But
your feet to the fire.
Yeah, now. Put me on a deadline, I'll get stuff done. But yeah, the World Cup, it was exciting. It was good. United States obviously won the gold medal, or won gold. They beat Japan, India, Georgia, and Azerbaijan. Gilman went 1-2, had a forfeit against India. When Gilman came out for his match against India, and they said, Thomas Gilman wins by forfeit, I thought people, I just assumed everyone was going to leave. Like, I could not believe that the Indian guy missed weight is what happened.
Okay.
But, like, I would just, depending on how far he was over, just put him out there anyway. I mean, I thought we were going to have a riot.
That's insane. I was wondering what was going on. I forgot to ask. So he blew weight. Wow. Yeah. So did you immediately see about, 3,000 fans get up and head to the Gable Garden?
I fully expected that, but the garden wasn't open yet.
Oh,
so
okay.
That probably helped. But I was standing there, and I was like, I was saying words that can't be repeated on Facebook Live. But, Gilman forfeiting, that was kind of sort of almost good news, because then we got to see Joe Colon faster. The former UNI Panther, third place in the country 3 or 4 years ago now. He won his match 6-4 coming from behind. I think it was down 4-0 at one point and came all the way back and won.
I think that guy from India is ranked too.
Yeah, I think that's what Blood Round said. That's shout out to Blood Round too. He's the guy. I hung out with him all weekend, all Saturday night. We won't talk about that. We'll save that for his podcast.
Oh,
but
juicy story. Download or subscribe to at Blood Round.
Yeah, right. But I'll watch. He probably won't talk about it. But yeah, him and Lars had a bunch of family and friends at, we were at Spoko for a little while, downtown Iowa City. It was a good time, but, Cologne won. It was great to see him. It was great to see all the backups. Hayden Zilmer went out there, got the win. That was cool. Don Bradley got the win too against India. That was good.
My God, the India match, I remember watching that one, and that was the one where Kyle Dake just absolutely murdered his guy, right?
Yeah. He came out and, I missed it because I was looking at my phone trying to upload pictures, and Dake just comes out in the first, second and a half and lifts his guy into the sky and, just throws him off the mat and then does it again right away. Like, it was just, what's going on?
Like, he came out, and he had kind of his low stance going, and, the whistle blew, and he immediately had a hold of that guy's ankle.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how do you let somebody grab your ankle that fast? And then he just, whoop, like you said, just.
It was amazing. And, I think when I sent out the Instagram photo, I was like, I totally missed it. This is all on me. I whiffed big time. And then my photo of Dake isn't even in focus. It's just I screwed that whole thing up.
And then David Taylor, I think, beat his guy even faster in that duel. I think it was
Yeah, he had a tech too. I don't remember how fast it was, but that whole India duel, like the whole thing was done in like an hour. It was just super fast.
Exactly. Yeah, it was amazing.
So just kind of overall, I think the World Cup, I think it was a success. At least for UWW, I think it was. I was a little surprised at the attendance number. It was just over 6,000 for both days. It felt like more people were there both days to me, but I don't know. I'm not very good at estimating crowd size, obviously.
What did you make of the Gable Garden and people being allowed to bring in their beverages into Carver?
So I probably have a different perspective than everybody because, like I said, I was on the floor. I'm far away from the fans. I'm close to the action, but I'm far away from the fans. And I like the beer, everything, it was a big success. I mean, I'm friends with a guy who works in the concession stands up there. And he was talking to the guy, the vendor. They said that they made $20,000 on beer the first day. And that's in 4 hours. The garden and the beer thing were only open for 4 hours, from 11 to 2:30 or something like that. So 3.5 hours. It's nuts. So they made $40,000 alone, probably, on beer. Like, why aren't we doing this more often? Like, I mean, I understand everything, but
I was just going to say, I mean, and I hate to get on like a soapbox, but it's like, it seems like, you know, companies and teams and everything's business related now, and it's about the bottom dollar. And if there's $40,000 over 2 days, or if you can, like you said, over 3 hours, they made $20,000, 3.5 hours. If there's that much money that's on the table and you're just leaving it off because you know, for whatever reason, I feel like you're right. It's just going to change because it's like there's so much more money we could be pulling in if we just.
Yeah. Well, and it's not like this isn't like a new thing for Carver. They sell beer in the fellow room before basketball games. Like, you can get beer if you know the right people and have the proper amount of money donated to whichever program at Iowa. It's really just beer for the masses is what we're interested in.
Yeah.
And, you know, this topic has been talked about to death and written about to death, and eventually it will change. But, you know, for now, I it was great. I mean, I may or may not, I'm not confirming or denying, but I may have had a beer in between sessions on Saturday. So, I mean.
You contributed to the number.
Gotcha. Maybe I did. Maybe I didn't. We don't know, unless you saw me and then. Well, let's not. Anyway, but yeah, it was great. Like, you go outside. If it were nicer out, it would have been better, obviously. But like, you go out, they had a guy up on a portable stage singing songs, like with the guitar, not just like randomly. They had the grilled cheese vendor from downtown Iowa City. That was great. Those things are awesome. They had a bunch of other vendors. They had clothing that you could just stand outside if you wanted to. It was great to get out of the arena for a little while. You can have an adult beverage. I thought it was great.
So you talk about, you know, obviously that, I mean, you would say the atmosphere was great then?
It was, like, so in the arena in Carver, like, there's nothing like wrestling in Carver. And it really got loud for Gilman and... Everyone really likes Kyle Digg.
Yeah.
I mean, with his throws and everything. Everyone cheered real loud for Burroughs and Taylor, and really, really everyone that anytime anybody won or got a pin or did something cool, and they got, the crowd woke up. The fans were great. I think the setup could have been better. I don't think that UWW does the best job with the mat placement, with the scoreboard placement, with the graphics on screen, with all that kind of sort of almost behind the scenes stuff. The scoreboards were blocking people's views. They were just in the way. I don't know why. I mean, they they set up the same way for every tournament they do, and I don't know why they don't kind of customize it to the arena a little bit more, but yeah. And then there were a couple more behind the scenes things that I thought could have went better. Could have been run a little bit smoother, I thought. It could have been done a little bit faster. But I mean, overall, I thought it was good. Like I said, just there were a couple things that could have been done better that I would have liked to see. But yeah, I think overall it was good. Did you watch it all on NBC Sports Network?
Yeah, I have NBC Sports Network, but I still watch on the NBC app just to kind of see what, I don't know, I wanted to make sure that I was definitely going to watch it.
Sure.
Because I didn't want to have to worry about looking at the schedule on the flipping from it between. The wife was nice enough to let me watch. Anyway, I thought it was amazing that I was able to pull up the NBC app and just watch wrestling on that. I mean,
I
was fully intending on having to buy that track subscription and plugging it in my computer, and that would have been kind of a mess. But I mean, it was awesome that something I already paid for had it. So,
yeah.
I mean, I'm not trying to really take a dig at Flow because that's kind of what it sounds like. But I mean, it just was really nice that, I mean, I'm the guy that loves convenience. So when I can be lazy and just flip my remote, I mean, that's putting me in heaven, man.
Yeah, and I think every wrestling match should be on TV. Like, what Flo does is great, what we do is great, what Trek does is great, but TV is, there's something, you know, it's different. More people can watch it, no matter what people say. Eventually TV cable will go away, but it's not yet. More people still have cable. Like, don't fall for that stuff. I mean, more people have cable still. Like, numbers are going down, but it's not close.
Right.
And just being able to flip, even just having the TV on NBC Sports Network, and then wrestling comes on, someone might be like, oh, this looks cool, it's the United States. And then they just, you know, watch a little bit. Like, that's so much better than, it's for me, than having to go and find, you know, a stream or something and then paying for it. I don't mind paying for it, but like having to go online and find it, I mean, it's right there. You don't have to do anything. That's great. And from what I heard too, John Smith was great on commentary.
Yes, he was.
Yeah, so it's always good to have knowledgeable guys who know what they're talking about. And yeah, the production value. If it was the same stream that they were showing in the arena, it seemed pretty good to me. I obviously wasn't watching it intently, but like, production values there, you get different angles on stuff, you get guys interviewed after matches, so like, I mean, hopefully some people tuned in, hopefully we'll see some numbers eventually. But yeah,
as far as the, you know, the actual wrestling, we kind of talked about Cologne had a nice match. You know, what did you have any thoughts on Gilman before I give mine?
The Japanese guy that he wrestled is the world gold medalist. He is fast, and people want to complain that he didn't do anything, but that guy is like, it was like lightning. Cause Gilman had him dead to rights a couple times, and yes, he just, it was gone. It was, what the hell happened? Like, I'm trying to think.
I was going to say, because in that the Japan match, you know, I guess the one thing to be just kind of singling that one out, not trying to break it down too much either, but
yeah.
I thought it was a definite improvement from where he was, you know, in the World Finals, Gilman, you know, as far as that. He definitely closed the gap, but I think what that match, you know, and I'm not trying to be an analyst expert, but I think, you know, Gilman's obviously got some work to do on finishing quicker on these elite-level guys. Because the fact that he didn't led to Takahashi, I think is his name, that led to him being able to do re-attacks. And like you said, he's so quick and he's slick on his feet that since Gilman didn't finish fast, I mean, he, you know, Takahashi took advantage of that and turned, like you said, a couple dead-to-rights takedowns into his scores. And that's really what beat Gilman in that first match.
Yeah, for sure. I just remember seeing, like, the – I mean, Gilman had it had him. Like, it was right yep. there. And then he's just gone. Like a magic trick. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, it's like, because it was like he, I don't know if it was like a wizard situation. He just had to, like, pull his arm out or something, and he would have been around him for two. And all of a sudden, Takahashi was just like, boom, like he said, he was right on top. Yeah. And like, what the hell?
Exactly. And then Gilman beat the Georgian 6-5, 6-4.
And that was the push-out match, right, where he just, like,
yes, yeah.
he had, like, five push-outs?
Five, yeah. Because that was the one where he got taken down once or twice. Once or twice, I don't remember. But I got some really good photos of Gilman getting taken down, but I got no good photos of Gilman scoring any points because they were all push-outs.
Right.
Like, well, darn. But then, you know, Gilman falling in the gold medal match. I'm not going to pretend to pronounce this guy's name. It's a bunch of consonants in a row. But he lost 8-7 in that one. He, the guy he was wrestling looked like he was like 47. I mean, he was one of those guys that just, I mean, I don't know how old he actually is, but he looked old. But yeah, I don't really want to break this down at all, but he looked good at times and kind of sort of not good at other times. I don't know. It's,
I mean, really from that one, it's just kind of like he's, you know, we know Gilman's got a gas tank and his guy gassed it a little bit to give Gilman a chance to come back.
Yeah.
I mean, really, but I don't know. Just Gilman's got to figure something out to finish in quicker on these elite level guys. I know, I hate going back to that, but, like, if you do that, you know, he's right there on that same plane as some of those other guys that you feel pretty good that every time they go into a world tournament, they're going to medal. And now maybe you're looking at this World Cup performance and you're kind of wondering are people starting to wonder, like, hey, Tony Ramos is coming back to 57. You know, is Gilman even going to win? Is Spencer Lee going to take his spot? I mean, we got the number two guy in the world, and I kind of feel like after this weekend, you know, a lot of that luster is kind of worn off, and people are already kind of wondering, you know, not to say they're writing him off, but are they really giving him the respect of a guy that's number two in the world, you know?
Yeah, right. I gotcha. I mean, I guess we'll see with Ramos, and it'd be cool to see Lee go senior level, but I don't, for some reason, I don't think he will. That's just, I have literally no information about it. I don't think he will.
Nic Ryder reported. He'll be in the junior trials. I got it right there.
Great. So then he will be in the senior trial. You're welcome. But yeah, like I said, it was good seeing some of those backups. It was neat seeing, you know, Burroughs and Dake and Taylor like all on the same team for once. Having 10 weights was good. I'm trying to think of like who else looked good. Steber looked good with his head wrapped in both ways with the blood. I mean, he lost that match, but, you know, it still looked kind of neat. Snyder looked great, obviously. I thought Jaden Cox looked good, even though he dropped that match to Azerbaijan. He's so big and strong and fast, like, and he's such a nice guy. Like, when he's out there, he shakes everyone's hands and he's real respectful of everyone and like hugs them after the match. And like, you're like, he's just like a big bear. I mean, I it's cool.
We get it. You love Missouri guys too. We get that.
Yeah. For sure. That's why I was pulling for Askren to get the Wisconsin job.
Exactly. you know, one of the reasons I asked you about that, the atmosphere is because obviously Iowa had a couple guys visiting this weekend.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah. Nick's favorite, Austin DeSanto, was in town, and Sadarian Perry from Eastern Michigan, an All-American there for who's got his program dropped, so he's essentially a free agent. So, a couple transfer guys, you know, looking at Iowa.
I'm pretty sure DeSanto and Lee sat together each session. Right next to each other. Marinelli was with Perry each session, so we kind of found them in the crowd a couple times. I mean, it's looking good for Iowa if you want them to transfer here. I'm not saying that I don't want him to transfer here. I'm just saying that it's looking good for Iowa, I would think. I mean, maybe they just had the weekend off and thought, hey, you know, maybe I'll buy a ticket and get seated next to Spencer Lee. But that's a pretty big coincidence. So
I was just going to say, and did you see, I mean, I'm not sure how active, and I know you were killing it on Instagram, but did you see, like, there was a ton of people, Iowa fans did their part to have their kids come up and want to take pictures with Austin DeSanto and be like, I feel like if you were wanted to get a taste of what it's like to be that kind of celebrity of being a Hawkeye in Carver Hawkeye Arena, I think DeSanto definitely got the experience. I'm not sure, you know, how much Perry got of that, but DeSanto, I saw tons of pictures of.
I think Perry got it a little bit too. I saw Marinelli getting his photo taken a couple times with some kids. And that's always really cool, like, you know, just being that, like, pseudo-celebrity and having that done. But I think even just being in Carver, I mean, even though there were only 6,000 people there each day, that's 500 and, you know, 5,600 people, more people than Perry and DeSanto have had at any of their college duels. I mean, it's a totally different atmosphere in Carver and with the Iowa fans. And, like, the attendance figures came out today. Like, they averaged a lot. What was it, 12 or 13,000? It was
like 1,800 more than Penn State, though, right?
Yeah, right.
And they wrestled, at Penn State and at Ohio State.
Yeah. So if there's, like, I mean, there's no better showcase for Iowa than what they had Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah, it's just crazy. Like, I'm sorry to, I mean, Iowa State, Penn State, Ohio State on the road. I think Penn State had two duels in Bryce Jordan Center, and they sold those out. And, obviously Iowa didn't have a sellout this year, and they still had 1,800 more fans per duel. And they have – Iowa had the Iowa City duels, which I know they beefed up this year, but that is still not a – that is the worst attended event, which would be probably a really great attended event at a different university, and that was terrible grammar, but
Well, it doesn't help that thing starts at, like, 10 a.m. on a Friday.
Exactly, but, I mean – yeah, just a lot of factors that Iowa's, like, 12 years in a row to keep leading. That's pretty incredible. So.
Overall, the World Cup was good. I know that the Iowa City Conventions Bureau thing is interested in putting in a bid for the World Championships, like the individual one, eventually. When they do that, if they do that, I don't know, but I know they want to. I know that's kind of their – like a goal for them.
I heard them talk before about maybe they'd have to host like cadets or junior worlds first before UWW would maybe give them seniors.
Of course.
And you're snoozing, but yeah. I mean, juniors for sure, I think would be, that would be something that'd be worth.
People would probably attend it because, especially if you get the, you know, an Iowa guy or two in there and, I don't know. I just have I'm just not that interested in the juniors and cadets.
Junior Worlds is pretty legit. I mean, Cadet Worlds, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm not going to wake up at 2 in the morning to watch Kurt McHenry. I mean, you know, he's really talented. I think he's a 2-time Cadet World champion, but I'm sorry, bud, like, you know, I'll read about it the next morning, but, you know, to watch Yanni Dakimahalis go out there and wreck some Russians in the middle of nowhere, that's pretty fun. So
just wrestle seniors. I mean, what's the problem?
Like, that's true. A lot of the guys do, but come on.
But anyway, World Cup, I think there's, like I said, some things behind the scenes that could be done better. Placement of scoreboards, for sure. Some graphic stuff. But, you know, that's just me. UWW seems to just do what they want, do what they always do, and do what they've always done. So, beer sales in Carver, it's great. It was a good time. I think hopefully everyone enjoyed it. I know the Japanese team enjoyed it. They had a kick-ass time. I mean, getting third. They beat Cuba. The Cuban coaches were furious just at the refs, the officials in that third place match. It was great. I was right there, and like the Cuban coach walked over there and talked to him and got a yellow card, and the Japanese team stormed the mat after they won their heavyweight match, and the Cuban just kind of fell on his back, and the Cuban guys came out and like got him back up, and that was by far the best match of the tournament. I mean it probably wasn't on TV or anything, but it was good. It was back and forth, and all the Japanese guys were super excited. It was pretty cool.
Did you see Josh Schomburger, who's out the Coralville, Iowa City Visitor Bureau? Did you see the photo he posted about the Cuban team, what they took home with them?
No.
All right, I'm gonna. If I send you a photo, can you put it up? Because you're on Mac, right?
Yeah, I mean.
So if I send you a photo, can you put it up on the stream too?
Yeah, I think so.
All right.
Wait, are you going to text it to me?
Yeah.
Oh, that might be a problem. This is great radio, by the way.
Yeah, I'm going to describe it, though. So, all right.
Oh, that makes it like better.
It's a big dolly, right? And it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 boxes on it. There's a 49-inch LED TV there's a Samsung, a big TV. I can't see the inches on it. 55-inch. I can see another 32-inch squared away in there. There's a Huffy, looks like Huffy bike, I'm guessing. I don't know what that box is. There's a stroller. So it looks like they just went to the mall and they bought a ton of stuff and then they checked it in for their flight home. They checked it. They checked all these boxes. So they took home like 5 TVs, man.
Yeah. I'm not going to be able to get this up on the stream, but it looks like they went shopping.
Yeah. It's awesome. So I don't know. Schomburger put that up like, Cuba's not messing around. So. That's amazing. That's what they did before they went home. Yeah, there you go.
There it is for those of you watching on the Facebook Live.
Yeah, so if you're listening
all tomorrow, the TVs.
So that was really fun to see Cuba do that.
I mean, getting stuff shipped down there is a pain. Amazon right. Prime doesn't go to Cuba. But... yeah, I mean, I think overall it was a success, and I probably said that like 4 times now, but yeah, it was a good time with Blood Round and Cassie, his sister, and I was gonna tell that. So, oh shit, now I give it away. I'm not gonna tell.
I'll save it
for another time.
All right.
But yeah, like. I think everyone had a good time. Bo Nichols, in town was recognized by USA Wrestling. So did Spencer Lee. He got the hammer or a hammer. I don't know.
Amateur Wrestling News gave that I don't know if that's their top, if that's their Hodge trophy.
Yeah. I don't know if it was like a special hammer or like if they just went to Ace Hardware and got a hammer or what the deal was really.
Right.
But Spencer Lee has a hammer now. So that's cool. And he was recognized, and Gable talked a lot, I'm sure, all weekend. He signed a bunch of autographs for everyone. Him and the UWW president, who I think is from Serbia. I don't know if that's right or not. But the president talked for a while on the mat in kind of broken English. And it kind of went on a little bit too long, and it kind of got like a little okay, guy, like we get it. Get off the stage. But they're like, it was weird because when he was talking, there was no music. And so eventually he's like, and now Dan Gable. So the crowd kind of claps and goes crazy. And then so it's real quiet again. And then some guy just like out in row 40 just yells, yeah, Dan Gable! Gable's just like, yeah, we get it. Everyone claps again. Like it was fun. Fire and stuff. All
pyrotechnics, yeah.
I don't really have anything else to say. Just
kind of
rambling.
Yeah. Well, so I guess, obviously it was a success. I've seen a lot of stuff come out of, maybe just because I follow them a lot, the Des Moines Register crew, Chad Lysakow, Cody Goodwin, seemed like they put out a lot of content on the good things said by the athletes. And I think obviously Iowa City, like you said, they want to get world championships. They'd probably want to host a World Cup again. So sounds like it was a great experience.
Yeah, for sure.
And, you know, now as a, collectively as a nation, we got World Cup over. It's time to start qualifying our guys for the 2018 Worlds, and that kind of starts, I mean, not next week, but the week after that is the U.S. Open, so we're already getting pretty, I mean, we're not going to be too far removed from some more wrestling.
Yeah, that's super soon. That's a lot sooner than I thought.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think that's, I think it's the senior, junior open. Usually Iowa sends a pretty good group out to Vegas for the Western Regional to qualify for Fargo. So, I mean, it's a lot of wrestling taking place here at the end of the month.
Yeah, for sure. You'll be busy writing previews.
Maybe.
All right. So, unless you have something else.
Oh, I'm good, man. This has been fun to return.
Yeah, we went a little long, about 50 minutes. So, sorry about that. I kind of rambled. No. Follow me on Twitter. I'm at Nic_Ryder. Follow Ross Bartachek at Ross Bcheck. What else? We weren't sponsored by anyone this week.
We're at IA Wrestle.
Yeah. Check out all the stuff at IARussle.com. I know Ross has been putting out putting out a bunch of stuff. You know, the last couple of days, and my piece against the, not against DeSanto, but my piece explaining my DeSanto thoughts is still up. You can check that out. I'm sure there's a thing about you and I's recruiting class up today that kind of got a little confusing at times, but that's okay. It's all straightened out now.
Let's leave it at that.
Yep. You follow us on Instagram. @IARussle. Follow us on Twitter @IARussle. But yeah, this has been Potentially Dangerous, episode 113. For Ross Bartachek, I'm Nic Ryder, and we'll see you next week. Get low when the whistle goes.